happy to be in the presence of Almighty God. Turn to somebody and say, you're sitting in His presence. Amen. God loves you amazingly. Beyond your imagination, He loves you. How many of you believe in God's love? Those of you who believe, shout a hallelujah. Today's message, I want to title it as Nourish, Cherish, Pamper, Protect Your Body. Turn to somebody and say, Nourish, Cherish, Pamper, Protect Your Body. This is a message you will not hear. You will always hear about the spirit and soul, but today I'm going to concentrate, focus on your body. Turn to somebody and say, your body is important to God. Very, very important. So last time I preached, I emphasized, I took a few points. I'll come back on those points, but I want to tell you something. Your body is very important to God. Amen? Don't neglect your body. Nourish it, cherish it, feed it, pamper it, protect it, discipline it. Your body is important to God. And we're going to see from Scripture why your body is so important to God. Because there was a time I thought body was not so important. I myself, as a pastor, I used to neglect my body like anything. I didn't care. I said, what is this? It's after all, God is after my soul, after my spirit. But after I made this discovery, I want to take better care of my body. Turn to somebody and say, please take care of your body. So I'm going to give you some scriptural basis for that. And I want you to open your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 29 to 31, Amplified Version. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 29 to 31. Let's all read. For no man ever hated his own flesh. Oh. Okay, put NLT version. I don't know why. This Amplified Version, it says flesh. NLT version. Okay, now this is good. No one hates his own body, but feeds and cares for it, just as Christ cares for the church. How many of you believe God loves the church? The Bible says that just like God loves the church, human beings are supposed to love their body, feed their body. Take care of your body. Give it a bath once in a way. Turn to somebody and say, please take care of your body. It's scriptural. Let's go back to the Amplified Version. No one ever hated his own body, but instead, he nourishes it. Everybody say, nourish your body. And carefully protects it. So tell your neighbor, protect your body. Thirdly, he says, cherish your body. Means, wow, it's like ice cream. Wow, your body is important. Cherish your body as Christ does the church. You know, Jesus loves the church. He loves the church. He enjoys being in our midst. He loves, and even though we might have some faults, some shortcomings, He loves the church. And He says, that's how you're supposed to treat your body. No one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes, cherishes, protects his body. Let's look at the Message Version. Message Version, chapter 5, verse 29 to 33. No one abuses his own body, does he? No. He feeds and pampers it. Turn to somebody and say, please pamper your body. I just came back from Kodai and my legs were so tired, so I just put my leg on my wife's lap and said, please pamper it. Give it a little massage. It's okay. It's not unscriptural. It's scriptural. No one abuses his own body, does he? No, he feeds and pampers it. That's how Christ treats us, the church. So when you take care of your body, you should know that Christ also takes care of the church like that. Sometimes the body stinks. Sometimes the church also stinks. I didn't hear an amen for that. So don't run away from the church. Love it. Wash it. Cleanse it. Pamper it. That's what Jesus will do. Some people, the moment something is a little wrong with the church, they want to jump like a grasshopper from one church to another church. Then in the second church, they'll again find something wrong. Boom. Jump. That's unscriptural. Just like your body can get dirty, you can sweat, you can smell. You just wash your body, cleanse it, sanctify it. And then you love your body. If anybody who doesn't love his body, come and somebody give me a blade. I just want to see how much they love their body or not. I want to cut your body and see. How many of you love your body? You protect your body. You feed 3 times a day. You pamper your body with nice perfumes, nice soap, and a nice bath. No one hates his own body but feeds and cares for it, just as Christ cares for the church. One Corinthians 9:27. Go to New King James Version. But I discipline my body. Turn to somebody and say, also discipline your body. And bring it to subjection. Lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become disqualified. So there are 7 things the Bible says you should do. Number one, nourish your body. Write it down. Write it on a screen. Number one, nourish your body. Number two, cherish your body. Don't talk ill of your body. Look at your body and say, you're beautiful. Look at yourself and say, you're beautiful. Turn to somebody and say, I got a beautiful body. Yeah, even if you have a little tummy like me or a little plump, don't say, look at this ugly body. No, don't disqualify your own body. Say you're beautiful. Turn to somebody and say you're beautiful. Say, I am beautiful. Nourish your body. Second, cherish your body. Third, protect your body. That's why we wear clothes. If you go to a cold place, you protect your body. Otherwise, your body will catch a cold. And it can freeze. In summer, you wear such clothes that will protect your body from sunlight. Number four, you feed your body with good things. Feed your body. Number five, pamper your body. It's all scriptural. Number six, care for your body. Take good care of your body. You cannot eat too much of oil, too much of chicken. Don't eat too much of rice. Care for your body. Number seven, discipline your body. Now, this is very important. After you've done all the six, please take care that you discipline your body. Fast at least once a week. It's good for your body. Turn to somebody and say, your liver needs some rest. Your intestines needs rest. Your heart needs a little ease. In every part of your body is precious to God. Shout amen. Say, my body is important to God. So last time we saw why the body is so important. Body is very important to God. You know, there's a time I thought only the spirit and soul was important. No. Your body is very important to God. I'm not saying your spirit is not important, your soul is not important, but your body is very important to God. Shout amen. So let's go to back to a little bit of revision of what we took last time. Genesis 1, 26 to 28, New King James Version. Then God said, let us, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, make man in our image, in the image of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So let us, the triunion God, make man in the triunion image and let them. So when we said the word man, the word was Adam. It is mankind. It is not just one singular man. It is mankind. So let us make mankind in our image and in our likeness. Let them, that's why, because it is mankind, it's not one man, it's mankind. Let them have dominion. So this is your job description. To the mankind, he gave a job description. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, over the cattle, over all the earth. So we are supposed to have dominion. So the first thing God did was, okay, I have heaven up above and earth and I own it, but I'm going to give to mankind the earth. So he made human beings in the image of God, and he gave the earth so that they can experience heaven on earth. Heaven in your family. Heaven in your business place. Wherever you are, God wants you to experience heaven before you go to be in heaven. I didn't hear a hallelujah. Don't have hell here and then go to heaven there. No. Have heaven here and go to heaven there. You're already in heaven. Amen. And when you die, you transit. That's it. And I'll show you why it's so important. So God's job description is the whole human mankind, Hindus, Muslims, anybody, you are supposed to be responsible for the earth, have dominion over the earth, have heaven on earth. That's why Jesus came. He said, repent and believe, for the kingdom of God is near. This is his prayer. Let your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. So he wants heaven to come down to earth. He wants to have dominion and have a heavenly principle, heavenly experience here on earth. He wants you to enjoy and have heaven on earth. And we are supposed to dominate everything, circumstances, environment, earth, nature, trees, herbs, animals, every creature except man. We are not supposed to dominate man. I cannot dominate my wife. I have to give her the freedom. So that domination, that rule does not come in terms of another human being. But everything else, you're supposed to have authority over the earth. Shout amen. And last time we saw that God gave the legal right. Everybody say legal right. For human beings with the body. Human. That word is from humus plus man. It's actually originally it is ish. Ish means spirit. So God made us in Genesis chapter 1. He didn't make the body. He made a spirit man. A spirit man. So man was spirit. And not only that, in verse 27 we said that first mankind was male and female together. So God created man, mankind, in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. And the two were one. And he came. So the first time he created, 1 minute you come. It is one spirit. Just male and female together. Mankind. This is Adam and Eve together. Then he operated. He operated. He's the first surgeon. He operated on Adam. Took Eve out. He put him to sleep, took him out, and then presented back to himself. So that the two will become one. Your husband and wife are not two. You're one. Turn to somebody and say, husband and wife are one. So when Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, that's when he creates the spirit man, male and female together. He formed him. He took the dust of the earth. Then the Lord God formed. It's not creation, it is formation. Turn to somebody and say, there's a difference between creation and formation. So the second time what happened was formation. For God formed, now is giving him a shape. So he took mud out and he says, out of the mud he created man, out of the dust of the ground. And he said, he breathed into, that's the breath of God, that's the spirit of God, into his nostrils, and the breath of life. And the man became a soul, a living being. So now he's got a body, he's got a spirit, and he's got a soul. Man became a living being. But he was man inside dust, formed. And then he gave them legal authority. So number one, if you don't have a body, you have no authority to be on earth. Shout amen. Say, a spirit without body has no authority on earth. That's why even Lucifer could not come and attack Eve without a body. So Lucifer, I believe, went to the serpent and said, can I borrow your body for some time? So Lucifer gets into the serpent, and then the serpent comes and deceives, because Lucifer could not directly deceive. Shout amen. Turn to somebody and say, when you leave your body, you have no authority on earth. Till you're clothed again. So no authority. So all what you want to do, you can do only till the time you have a body. That's why body is important. Anything you want to do on earth, you cannot do after you leave your body. Demons are illegal. Demons are illegal. So the Bible says 2,000 demons got into a man. And when Jesus came, he said, I cast you out. All of you get out. The demons begged. Can we enter another body? Can we enter the body of pigs? Because spirits without body are illegal on earth. Shout amen. So why your body is important? Your body is a fight, a place of fight between the Holy Spirit and demons, between sickness and life, between death and life. So your body is a struggling, fighting place for spirits of sickness and life. So there's a fight going on for your body, either life or death. Demons or the Holy Spirit. You cannot be neutral. So there's a constant fight going for your body. And your body, God wants to fill your body with the Spirit. Shout amen. And God will not interfere with the affairs of the earth without a body. That's why even Jesus, when God wanted to interfere and redeem the world, the first time he came to redeem human mankind. The second time he's coming again to redeem the whole creation. How many of you know when Jesus comes again, there's no more pain. He's going to redeem the whole universe. Shout a hallelujah. The first time he came to redeem man. And God, it's his principle that he will not interfere with the affairs of the earth without a body. So he sent Jesus. He sent Jesus to Mother Mary and said, listen, the Holy Spirit came to, through an angel, came to Mary and asked, can we borrow your womb? We want to give birth to God in a human body. And that's Jesus coming in a body. And Mary said, yes, let it be according to your word. She gave permission for Jesus to operate on earth. That's why Jesus is born. Now you have somebody who's God without sin coming into a body and said, now I'll take back the authority, the dominion that Satan has misused mankind. I want to redeem and replace and give them back the authority. That's why Jesus came, to give you back dominion, authority over the earth, over everything. Shout a hallelujah. He came back. And God, I tell you, will not interfere. That's why prayer is the most important activity in your life. Because without prayer, it's a principle. You need to ask and it will be given to you. You need to knock. Why? God can do without it, but he has put a principle. Unless a human being open his mouth and ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it shall be open to you. As if God cannot do without it. He knows, but he still wants you to ask because you and I have authority in the human body. That's why the body is important. After you're dead, you cannot pray. Turn to somebody and say, if you want to come for night prayer, come before you die. Yeah, in your sick bed, you're about to die. You say, I wish I could be in the night. No use. When you have life, you know, I learned this when I was in prison. When I was in prison, I couldn't come to church. I couldn't go to night prayers. I couldn't attend. And for 5.5 months, I could do only one thing, sit and pray and read the Bible inside the prison. But one thing in that 5.5 months, I decided, if I get out, I'm going to serve the Lord all the days of my life. I will not miss a single opportunity. If I get an opportunity, I'm not going to miss it. I'm not going to waste my time. I'm going to value my time because God is going to give me one more opportunity. This, I'm going to make full use of that opportunity. Some of you are wasting your time in dead things, things that are not useful for eternity. You're just absolutely wasting your time in your body. Shout amen. And God will not do anything on earth without a human being. I like what John Wesley said, so beautiful. Without God, man cannot do anything. But without man, God has decided he will not do anything. So he needs human body. That's why when Jesus rose from the dead, he's now going. He said, I'll go and I'll come back. But till I come back, my work, I give it to you guys. So he trusted these 12 guys. He said, wait, your body will be filled with the Holy Spirit and your body will become my temple. Greater work than what I did, I will do through your body, through you. So he believed in each one of us that we will take the good news and all over the world. So that's our assignment. Shout amen. God said, Jesus said on the cross, when he died, he said, it's finished. And if you're expecting Jesus to do something, it's finished. You got to do something with the Holy Spirit. There's only one person out here, the Holy Spirit. You allow him to be filled in your body. You can do amazing things. You and I can do amazing things. One with the Holy Spirit is a majority. Clap your hands and give him praise. So the Word of God doesn't say your spirit is the temple of the Holy Spirit. It doesn't say your soul is the temple of the Holy Spirit. It says your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Your body is important to God. But the devil wants your body also. He wants to put all kind of filth into your body. And don't allow. Don't allow the devil. Your body, actually the purpose of your body, biblical. Number one. Go to Philippians chapter 1, verse 19 to 21. And we are all going to read that together. 1, 2, 3. Philippians chapter 1, verse 19 to 21. 1, 2, 3. Here we go. So now also, Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. Christ has to be magnified. You know, there's only one person who will raise you up from the dead. That's Christ. That's the Holy Spirit. How many of you know that you need him even when you are dead to resurrect your body? He says, Paul says, I don't care whether I'm dead or alive, but one thing I want to know, all the time, Jesus has to be magnified in my body. Everybody say, Christ wants to be magnified in your body. If you allow him, he says, he wants to so operate in your body. He wants to magnify his name through your body. Turn to somebody and say, your body is important to Jesus. He wants to be magnified in your body. Next sentence is, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. He says, doesn't matter. It's not about life or death. All that matters is Jesus will be magnified in my body. Say that. Even as you say that, some diseases are leaving now. I just saw that. Turn to somebody and say, let Christ be magnified in my body. Every disease, you're unauthorized in my body. It's not you will be magnified. Christ will be magnified. Cancer cannot be magnified. Heart problem cannot be magnified. Diabetes cannot be magnified. But let Christ be magnified in my body. Shout a hallelujah. Clap your hands and give him praise. Speak in tongues for a few minutes. Mokotolo no robo. Hedele nerebe sele nerebe. Hudalana rabashe. Let the Holy Spirit be magnified in your body. Come on, open your mouth and speak in tongues. Mosolo no robo. Reketele nerebe nerebe se. I didn't hear you open your mouth. Some of you are sitting quiet. Some of you are not opening your mouth. Reke telene rebe. Ronko tolono robo. Reke telene rebe. Let Christ be magnified in each one of the bodies over here. Jesus be magnified. The Holy Spirit be magnified. Let Christ be magnified in our body. in our body, every disease, I command you to leave in the name of Jesus. It's no longer I, but Christ who lives in me. The life that I now live in this flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God. Your disease, you have no right to be in my body. Get out! In Jesus' name. Resist the devil. Resist sickness. Shout amen. So your body, number one, it is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Number two, your body has to magnify Christ. Number three, 2 Corinthians 4, 7 to 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7 to 10. But we have this treasure. The treasure is Christ in me, the Holy Spirit. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels. The earthen vessel is your body. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. We are hard-pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our body. Your body is for the manifestation of the life of Christ. Turn to somebody and say, your body should manifest life. That's why it doesn't matter whether you're 63, 64, it doesn't matter. My one prayer is, wherever I go, I have to bring life. Turn to somebody and say, wherever you go, don't put a gloomy face, sorrowful face, deathful face. Keep smiling. Bring life. Bring life wherever you go. That's what your body is there for. So if Jesus doesn't come back when I'm 85, don't think that I'll be standing with the 85. Whatever strength I have, I'll be dancing. Shout a hallelujah. Say, the life of Jesus should come out of your body. Your face, your smile, your complexion, everything. Pamper your body with the life of Christ. Turn to somebody and say, please pamper your body with the life of Christ. How many of you want to pamper your body with the life of Him? Everybody say, the life of Jesus may be manifested in your body. He want to manifest means show. He want to showcase His life through your body. How many of you have gone to the showroom, Toyota showroom? They showcase all the cars, polish it, paint it nicely, shining. That's how you should be. Paint it. It's okay. Put lipstick. Paint it. Brush. And then show off Jesus. Turn to somebody and say, my body is very important to God. Number three, your body is a seed. Turn to somebody and say, my body is a... 1 Corinthians 15, verse 36 to 38. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 36 to 38. Foolish one, what you sow is not made alive unless it dies. And what you sow, you do not sow that body that shall be. Means, when you're dead and we bury you, we're not burying just some body. We are burying a seed. Your body is a seed. Turn to somebody and say, please take care of your body. Your body is a seed. When you're dead, then we put you inside and nail you up, You're burying a seed. That's what the Bible says. But mere grain, perhaps, so what kind of body we are going to bury? What kind of body you're going to bury? Perhaps wheat or some other. Sometimes we have to bury the lemon seed because throughout their life they were always complaining and crying. So that is a lemon seed. Some is mango seed, always always joyful. That's a mango seed, sweet. Ask your neighbor, what kind of seed will you be when you die? Because the next sentence says, 38, but God gives a body as He pleases, and to each seed its own body. Don't expect to sow a lemon seed and get a mango tree. No way. Turn to somebody and say, you better get corrected now. Change your attitude now. Because we don't plant a lemon seed and expect a mango tree. No, God is not going to do that miracle. What kind of seed you are, that kind of tree you will be for eternity. Imagine eternity, you get up, you'll be saved because you believe in Jesus. But all the time in eternity also, you're sad. Turn to somebody and say, rejoice. Always rejoice. Again, I say rejoice. Pray without ceasing. In everything, give thanks. For this is the will of God. Amen. So your body is a seed. Your body is a seed. First Corinthians 6, verse 13. 1 Corinthians 6 verse 13. Now this one, everybody stand up and read, okay? Just to wake you up, because some of you will tend to sleep when you read this. So everybody stand up. If somebody is not standing up, wake that person up and say, stand up. Okay, if you're with a baby, I give you exemption. You are exempted. Okay, 1, 2, 3, here we go. Read. Shake hands with at least 3 people and say, sexual immorality, mamnua. Sexual immorality not allowed. Sexual immorality is not allowed. The state can legalize it. The country can legalize it. Anybody can legalize it. But I tell you, sexual immorality is a sin inside the body. Don't do it. Don't do it. Whatever grace theology, whatever theology you have, one thing I tell you, I recommend you, don't get involved into sexual immorality. If any of you are involved, I will still love you. I will pray for you. But I tell you, you are getting closer to death. That's one sin that is done inside the body. Run away from it. If any of you are addicted to it, you're hiding from it, come and meet me. You need deliverance. We need to pray for you. Don't be addicted to any kind of sexual immorality. Food for the stomach, stomach for the food. But God will destroy both it and them. Now the body is not for sexual immorality, but for the Lord. Next. No. With previous. But for the Lord. And the Lord for the body. Lord wants your body. The spirit of lust and sexual immorality also want for your body. See, they go for your body. There's a fight between the spirit of lust and the spirit of God for control over your body. And the Lord told me one of the reasons why the church is powerless is many in the church are into sexual immorality. We need to get out of it. We are not saying okay to it. It's not okay. You can be my daughter, my son. I'll call you my daughter, my son. But if you're in sexual immorality, come out of it. I don't care who you are, but get out of it. Don't think that the Lord doesn't see. He sees you, watches over you. Sometimes when I pray for you, God shows me faces of people directly into adultery. He showed me faces. So get out of it. I just warn you, please don't play with this. Shout amen. Say, the Lord is for my body. I give my body as a living sacrifice. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. Let's all read that. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present what? Present what? Present what? Present what? Tell my body is to be presented. It's not just your offering. When you come, you have to present your body as a living sacrifice. Means you are alive, but you're considered, as far as sin is concerned, my body is dead. You're telling that. Every time you come for communion, he's saying, Jesus, you died. Now I'm coming. I'm dead to sin. Dead to sin. As far as sin is concerned, you have nothing in me because I'm dead as far as sin is concerned. I'm alive for the Lord. Holy, acceptable God, which is your reasonable service. Your body has been purchased by his blood. Say, your body doesn't belong to you. Turn to somebody and say, your body doesn't belong to you. Now listen to me. If you don't do this, you have a problem with marriage. I'll come to that. If you haven't passed this test, your marriage is in shackles. The first test you have to pass if you want to have is understand this, that my body has been purchased. What happens in a church, in a marriage? Some years back, 35 years back, I went to the altar and gave my body to my wife. What Jesus did on the cross, I did. From that time, my body doesn't belong to me. It belongs to her. And her body, nobody dare touch. It doesn't belong to anybody but me. Her body belongs to me. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 2 onwards. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 2 onwards. Because of sexual immorality, let each man have its own wife. That's why if you find your child, 17-year-old kid, into sexual immorality, bring him to me, we'll get him married. See, I tell you, the maximum amount of sexual immorality sins I did from the age of 17, 18 to the age I got married, 29. So when my daughter was 19 only, I got her married. I said, let her be saved. So some people say, you're so young. Yeah, it is better than sexual immorality. Let each man have his own wife. Let each woman have her own husband. Next, verse 3. Let the husband render to his wife affection due to her. Husbands, where are you? Husbands, can you stand up? All husbands. All husbands, 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 all the husbands. Married guys, husband, yeah, husbands, husbands, husbands. Go to at least three other husbands and say, please render kindness, affection to your wife. Yeah, don't be nashmosh, kadabada, adabada, adibdi, ibdi. Be kind to your wife. Some of you are thugs. You're so rough with your wife. No, 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 no. Be kind. Please be seated. Says, husband, render to his wife the affection due to her. And likewise also, wife, get up. All the wives get up. Turn to your wife, to some other lady and tell, please, your husband is not a dustbin for your words. As you throw trash, you throw words, and the trash can is filled early morning only. Turn to at least two people and say, stop verbal diarrhea. Loose motion. Some women, if they open their mouths, it's loose motion. Please be seated. Next, verse 4. Wife does not have authority over her own body. So if you don't understand the first concept, that Jesus died, he gave up his body so that he will have your body. The same thing happens in a marriage. You've given up your body. Then you cannot say, I'll do what I want to. You belong to the devil when you say that. I'll do what I want. I need some space. You need the devil, not space. Yeah. You can't say that because you don't have any concept of kingdom principles. Even you say that. You're out of the kingdom when you say, I'll do what I want. Then you're just in the kingdom of Satan. You gave your body. The wife does not have authority over her own body. But the husband does. And likewise, the husband does not have authority over his own body. But the wife does. Your body is important to your spouse. Your body is important to your spouse. Next, verse 5. Do not deprive one another. Actually, when you get to heaven, you'll be responsible for those people who deprived your husband. If you are able but still deprived your husband or wife and say, I don't want to have sex. I'm very cutty with you. No sex for 1 month. Podi. Unbiblical. That's straight from the pit of hell. Because you have no right over your body. You gave it at the altar of marriage. You said, my body belongs to my husband. Now what are you saying? My body belongs to me. I'll do what I want. You are not married. You are just a disgrace. Change your attitude. When we are kingdom people, we have to have kingdom principle. Amen. So what are you supposed to do with your body? Listen to this. Very important. What are you supposed to do with your body? It's what Jesus did with his body. Go to John chapter 1, verse 14. This is very important. John chapter 1, verse 14. Everybody read that. 1, 2, 3. Wow. The Word of God became flesh. Became the body. When Jesus walked on earth, that's Word of God walking on earth. Is the walking Word. And God desires that you become a walking Word. If they kick you, Word should come out. If they slap you, Word should come out. Anything they do to you, Word should come out. You are the living good news. Turn to somebody and say, you are the living good news. Anybody who just encounters you should encounter the Word of God. Every sickness will leave because He will send His Word and heal you. I don't know about you. How many of you preach the word? Just Shane, Anselm, Pastor Raju, preach the word. How many of you feel full life when you preach the word? I mean, you get an extra energy that you can't get because there's life in the word. And that will come to your flesh. I want you to change your attitude towards your body. Say, lift your hand and say, let the word become flesh. In my body. My liver, my lungs, my pancreas, my heart, every part of my blood, all my flesh, all my bones, all my nerves, receive the word of God. The more and more I get the word will become flesh, full of grace, full of truth. Clap your hands and give him praise. God wants to penetrate with his revelation of truth through your spirit, through your soul, and manifest in your body. Manifest. The glory of the word should come out through your body. Everybody say, the word became flesh. Proverbs 14, verse 30. Proverbs 14, verse 30. Proverbs 14, verse 30. 1, 2, 3, here we go. Read. So the condition of your heart can determine the condition of your body. The sounder the heart is, the healthier the body. Everybody says, sounder the heart, the sounder my spirit, the sounder my soul, there is more life in my body. How many of you want life? Life. Everybody say life. Life in my body. I want more life. I want more life. The sounder, it means the cleaner. Your heart. The better the health. So you cannot have continue to have dirt in your heart, envy in your heart, filth in your heart, and expect life in your body. Proverbs 18, verse 8. Everybody, 1, 2, 3, here we go. The words of a tale-bearer means, okay, we'll put the message version, you'll know who's a tale-bearer. Tale-bearer. Message version. Listening to? One more time. Listening to? Listening to? So tale-bearer is, this guy carries tale. Through WhatsApp. Ching. WhatsApp is the fastest means of gossip. And now we make group gossip. Put all the family into one and gossip, mass gossip. Listening to gossip is like eating cheap candy. Do you really want junk like that in your belly? How many of you have stomach problem? Say, stop the gossip. No, I didn't say, the Bible says, stop the gossip, your belly will be better. Shout a hallelujah. Amen. No gossip. I liked what one day Daniel Batela did. Daniel Batela, I was with him. And we were sitting. Suddenly there was a gossip. He got up and went. Calvin also does that. You talk ill of anybody, Calvin doesn't want to hear. He says, that's not my portion. I don't even want to hear. Whenever you find gossip, no? Get out. Run away from that because it's not good for your body. Turn to somebody and say, gossip is not good for your body. They're very tasty like ice cream, but not good for your body. Turn to somebody and say, gossip is not good. All the women, can you tell it loud? One more time, I didn't hear. Even to my wife, there are some things, you know, my sister or somebody will say, I will refrain from telling her. Because poor thing's body will be affected. Listening to gossip is like eating cheap candy. Shout amen. So speaking gossip, listening to gossip. There's one more, very important to the body. Matthew 6:22 and 23. The eye is the lamp of the... One more time, everybody say the eye. One more time. Shake up Reuben and wake him up and say, the eye is the lamp of the body. Let's just give him a slap. I give you permission. That's nice. Amma, or adi kudu. Yes. Say, eye is the lamp. All the children get up. All the children. All the kids get up. All the children, wow. All of you run to the front. All the young people, less than 20, run to the front. Less than 20 years, run to the front. Come on the stage. Worship team, come on the stage. Young people, yes. Wow. Clap your hands for them. Clap your hands. Yeah, give them a big God bless you. Clap. Young people, less than 20. Clap your hands for them. Wow. Nice army. Today we started the class. Where's Ria? She's less than 20, I thought. Did you become more than 20? So we started the class for the young people. 7 or 8 came. For those of you who didn't come, don't worry. Register yourself. And we have started the class from now. Okay, so who's going to say come? You come. Tell me what you learned today. You're going to tell the children, okay? What did you learn?
We learned about how to receive the love of God because you can only pass on what you have. So,
1 minute. So, what did you learn? You learned how to receive
the love of God.
You know, because you cannot give anything that you don't have. Nicole, come here. Can you give me 2,000 dirhams? Why? You don't have. That's exactly what I'm saying. If you don't have the love of God, you cannot give it. So, how many of you want to receive the love of God? Lift your hand. So these kids are going to teach you. Wait, don't run away. Don't run. They're going to be teachers. How many of you want them to teach? Come, Ria. Ria, come here. Who else was there in the class today morning? Come. Watch me. 1 year from now, you're going to see these people teach. Because God gave me an assignment. At least minimum 24 people I have to train. And I'm going to be in love with you. So, can you give me a language of love? Show me a language of love you learned today. Amen? How many of you want your children to learn something? Bring them at 1 o'clock. What time? Yeah, that's the way to make sure you also come in time. Clap your hands for them. Now be on the stage. Now kids, I want to say, take care of what you see. Don't see any nonsense on the phone. Because the eye, look at that. Can you all read that from the screen? 1, 2, 3, here we go. How many of you want your body to be full of light? Be careful what you see. If you see filth, if you see unwanted things, just throw it away. Don't keep seeing demonic things. Some of the games that you're playing is demonic. So don't go for that. Different kind of games I recommend. Parents, have a watch on what you see. Because you don't want your children to be full of darkness. You want their bodies to... How many of you want your children's body to be full of light? You are the first Sunday school teacher. If you don't take care, who will take care? All the parents, lift your hand and say, I have responsibility to watch over my children. Say, I am the pastor for my family. Amen. Clap your hands for them. Be there, be there, be there. You're going to be my preachers. 1 Corinthians 6:19. Do you not know that your bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. Turn to somebody and say, you are not your own. Next sentence. For you were bought at a price, and the price is this blood. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. How many of you want to honor God with your bodies? Amen? I have the second part of the message. I'll continue later. It all deals with the body of Christ. You are the body of Christ. Turn to somebody and say, I am the body of Christ. I want you to close your eyes for a minute.